Welcome to Amazing Child Innovators. Today I will discuss five individuals who invented something during childhood that had an impact on the lives of those around them. Our first child innovator is Louis Braille. Braille was born in France in 1809. He loved to accompany his father into his workshop, and he had an accident there at the age of 3, which blinded him in one eye. He became infected and spread to the other eye, leaving him completely blinded. With the help of his family, Louis was determined to be able to do things on his own. He learned his letters using leather strips made by his dad and by pounding nails into boards. Louis's family sent him to a school for the blind. At the same time he was entering that school, Captain Charles Barbier of the French Army invented sonography, or night writing, a system of embossed symbols used by soldiers to communicate silently at night on the battlefield. Young Louis was inspired by a lecture Barbier gave at the school and adapted Barbier's system to replace the system the school used for reading, which was way too cumbersome. Louis' reading system was a finger-sized 6-dot code based on the 25 letters of the French alphabet, which could be recognized with a single contact of one digit. He continued to develop this code throughout his life. Using the Braille system, students were also able to write by punching dots into paper with a pointed stylus, which was aligned with a metal guide. Louis Braille died of tuberculosis in 1852. Due to reluctance to give blind students opportunities to learn on their own without high-priced tutors, the Braille writing system was not fully accepted until 1854. The system was first used in the United States in 1860. Our next child innovator is Frank Epperson. Epperson was born around 1894 in California. Epperson always knew he wanted to be an inventor from a very young age. At age 10, he devised a hand car that used both hands. It could go twice as fast as the existing one-handed hand car. However, it was his experimentation with soda water flavorings that led to his best known invention. Frank loved to mix up different flavored soda. One unusually cold night, he left one of his sodas outside with a stirring stick. The drink froze on the stick, thus providing Frank with a new treat. He would serve this treat to family and friends, but did not really think much about it and pursued a career in real estate. Once ice cream bars started to have popularity, he remembered his invention. In 1922, he showed off his treat at a fireman's ball, and it was such a hit that he began manufacturing the product, which he named the Epsicle, and selling it at concession stands around California. In 1924, he patented his idea and changed the name to Popsicle. Due to financial difficulties, he sold his rights to the product in 1929. Epperson pursued inventing different products for the rest of his life, including a sunscreen, a powdered drink, and a rotary engine for airplanes. Epperson died on October 22, 1983. Next up, we have George Neeson, father of the trampoline. Neeson was born February 3, 1914, in Iowa. As an 11-year-old, he began pursuing gymnastics and tumbling and continued throughout high school. When Neeson was 16, he was attending a traveling circus and got the idea for an apparatus that would facilitate more flipping and bouncing and help him train for his sports. In his basement at the age of 16, he devised the first version of what would become the trampoline, then called a bouncing rig. Once Neeson went to college and began his gymnastics career, he and his coach improved on the design to make it more bouncy. He named his invention the trampoline, derived from the Spanish word for diving board. He and his coach later went into business together and opened a factory to produce trampolines and other gymnastic equipment. Sales were slow at first, but Neeson was a great promoter of his product. At one point, he rented a kangaroo and trained it to bounce with him on the trampoline. He convinced military to purchase trampolines to train divers and pilots. After serving in the Navy during World War II, he returned and went on tour with his wife, also an acrobat, their baby, and a folding trampoline on a gas station tour across the country. He continued to promote trampolines for health and fitness into an old age. At the age of 63, he set up a trampoline on top of a flattened pyramid in Egypt and did flips. He died on April 7, 2010, just after his biggest dream was realized. Trampolining became an Olympic sport. Our next inventor, Mark Leshinsky, is a true child inventor. At age 15 presently, he has become a member of the National Gallery of America's Young Inventors since 2015. At the age of 8, Mark came up with the idea of the self-disinfecting hazmat suit for healthcare workers during the largest Ebola virus disease epidemic in 2014. Although it was originally designed to protect healthcare workers from Ebola virus, it can be used for protection against any highly contagious disease. Mark improved the suit by further perfecting the design and adding cooling, coloring, evaporating, and thickening agents in addition to the disinfecting solution. Mark went on to invent other practical items, such as a medicine bottle that could be opened with one hand for those with Parkinson's disease, and the fire eye device designed to protect people from entering a room in the house with a fire inside. He comes from a family of inventors. His dad applied for patents for his devices because he was too young to do so. Mark Leshinsky is determined to make his world a better place. He stated, "If there's a problem that can be solved, I want to be involved." Mark also has an interest in documentary filmmaking, making his first film at the age of 11 as he's opened a 501c nonprofit company to inspire other young people throughout the world to express their views by making film. Next up, we have Chester Greenwood. Greenwood was born in Farmington, Maine on December 8, 1858. He worked hard from a young age to help his family sell goods produced on their farm. Widely known and celebrated as the inventor of earmuffs, Chester actually didn't invent them. There were earmuffs before he was even born. Chester was dissatisfied with the job these mufflers did in warming his ears, so at around age 15, he started to experiment with different designs. Previous to that time, earmuffs were usually secured at the neck and did not stay in place very well. He received a patent at age 19 for earmuffs made with a tighter steel band that held the mufflers in place. His idea became popular enough that he established a company, Greenwood's Ear Protection Factory. The town of Farmington became known as the earmuff capital of the world, especially when he began supplying earmuffs to U.S. soldiers in World War I. Soon, the original design was modified, adding hinges for the earphones to be folded and carried in pockets, and for them to be adjustable to fit better. By 1936, annual output exceeded 400,000 pairs. Greenwood would acquire over 100 patents over the course of his lifetime, including the steel tooth rake, a wide bottom kettle, and a shock absorber design that led to components in airplane landing gear that are still used to this day. In 1937, Greenwood passed away at the age of 79. In 1977, the government of Maine declared December 21st Chester Greenwood Day, and a parade is held every year in Farmington in his honor. Hope you have enjoyed this glimpse at some young people who worked very hard to share their hobbies and passions and thus made the world a better and, in some instances, happier place. Please check out some of the resources used as I prepared this presentation. First of all, Gale Biography and Context, which is available in our digital resources collection. Three books I used were Six Dots by Jen Bryant, The Boy Who Invented the Popsicle by Anne Renaud, and Earmuffs for Everyone by Megan McCarthy. Thanks for watching. See you soon in the library.